Good morning. Our call to worship this morning is the doxology. It's hymn number 815. If you need it, please let's stand as we sing. You may be seated.
Well, I too say good morning. Welcome to Pine Valley Bible Church. We're so glad you've come out to worship with us today, especially considering our special guest speaker today. And we want to certainly welcome any guests or visitors who are here and say hello to our Facebook and YouTube friends from around the world. But before we do anything else, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for the blessing of being able to worship you in our own building in person. Father, we're also so appreciative for the fact that you loved us so much. You sent your Son, who was willing to go to the cross, pay the penalty for our sins, that we might, by simply placing our faith in Jesus, have everlasting life with you. And so, Father, we pray that our worship today will reflect the great love you've shown to us, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I have just one announcement today, and that is that this Saturday is Ladies' Prayer Breakfast at 8 a.m. right here. And let's continue our worship today by singing hymn number 12, Praise Him, Praise Him. Please let us stand if you're able. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. I'm glad that you're here today. And I want to thank Bob Tolson for being here today, too. It's quite an honor to have you here, sir. And we're looking forward to you bringing a message from God's Word for us today. Our scripture reading today comes from Matthew chapter 14, beginning in verse 22. Matthew chapter 14, beginning in verse 22. Immediately, he made his disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side, while he sent the crowds away. After he sent the crowds away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when it was evening, he was there alone. But the boat was already a long distance from the land, battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them, walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It's a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter said to him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. But seeing the wind, he became frightened and began to sink. And he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and took hold of him and said to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind stopped. And those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Certainly you are the Son of God." We'll continue our worship service today by singing hymn number 33, "Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise." And please again, if you can, stand. Guide us into the truth, that we would leave here changed people because of it. And we'll ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated, and the children are now dismissed to their classes.
Don't get old. When I was teaching at Philadelphia College of Bible, I was invited to speak at another church. And the deacon got up to introduce me. And over on the side, they had stained glass windows. One window was broken out, and they had a piece of cardboard pasted there. And he said, "We're glad to have Dr. Tolson with us today. He's not a substitute. He's like that window. He's a real pain." So I warned you. We're going to look at a miracle today. Last time I was here, we looked at the feeding of the 5,000, and today we want to look at Peter walking on the water. If you've ever traveled to the Near East, you may have been able to see Oriental silversmiths working in great bazaars. They work with coins that have been given to them by Western tourists. They melt them down, and then they form them into small pieces of jewelry. Eventually, they sell them back to the tourists, whoever are willing to buy them, and it's done in a very primitive way. Generally, there's a small furnace over which sits a pot containing the molten silver. The coin is dropped in the pot, and it begins to melt. And every so often, the silversmiths will go over to the pot of silver, look into it, scrape off a bit of the dross that he's collected, and then turns to his work. After a while, he looks in, finds the silver ready, and begins to form it. We might ask him, why do you constantly look into the silver? And he would say, I look into the silver until I find that the dross is all gone and the silver purified. I know when the dross is gone because I can see myself reflected in the silver like a fine mirror. And I think that's the explanation of that wonderful passage in Malachi, which God tells us he shall sit like a refiner and a purifier of silver. That's why believers are called upon to pass through fires and tests of life. It's the desire of God to make us like his Son, Jesus Christ. And he does it by removing the dross from our lives until his image is reflected in us and the world is able to see it. The Christian life is almost an impossible life. It's just as impossible as walking on water as a human being. Yet living it is just as possible and as wonderful as Peter's great feat of walking on water. The Christian life is really the life of our risen Lord flowing through us as we're united to him. His Spirit enables us to manifest those qualities that are supernaturally Christian. We do not always do the impossible, as we shall see, because sometimes we fail. But we don't gain acceptance from God by the things that we do. He works in us. He works through us. It's a life of grace. It's the life of the Holy Spirit lived in us for the glory of God. But God does test us, and God does try us to produce within us true Christian character. In our lives, there are storms of correction for discipline, and there are storms of perfection to help us grow spiritually. Jonah experienced a storm because he disobeyed God and needed to be corrected. The disciples encountered a storm because they obeyed Jesus and needed to be perfected. So we want to look at our passage and see what the Holy Spirit has for us today. First of all, we're on the shore. And immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And after he had sent the multitudes away, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. And when it was evening, he was there alone. Now this miracle is often called an appendix to the previous miracle, which was the feeding of the 5,000. This miracle takes place on the evening of that same day. But this is not the miracle where our Lord was in the boat in a storm. This is a different one. When our Lord sends the disciples away, there's a note of urgency in the scene. The text says, immediately he made the disciples get into the boat. So I think our Lord used gentle but firm pressure to cause the disciples and the multitude to leave. They were reluctant to depart, but Jesus said they had to leave. And you wonder, why did Jesus dismiss the multitude he has just fed and then send the disciples away? I think there's several reasons for this action. First of all, it was growing late and many of the people were quite a ways from home. The people were not eager to leave Jesus and they were not ready to leave him. And our Lord wanted to be alone for a time of prayer with his Father. But I think the real reason is the crowd was filled with wrong ideas about Jesus. And we know exactly what the crowd was thinking and saying from John 6:15. Jesus, therefore, perceiving that they were intending to come and take him by force to make him king, withdrew again to the mountain by himself alone. The disciples were not really free from wrong ideas about the Messiah. The people were thinking in terms of a political redeemer, not a spiritual redeemer. They were ready to elevate Jesus and rebel against Rome. And the disciples did not need to be infected with its spirit. The disciples were human. They loved the bask in the reflected glory of Jesus. And they may have been thinking of the high positions they would have if Jesus were king. And in their position in the kingdom, they would have a lot of prestige and a lot of power. So it's a dangerous thing to be exposed to wrong ideas and philosophies and to allow your mind to dwell on them. So their bright day was going to end in a dark night, but the darkness and the peril and the storm was a lot safer for them than the light of the day. Spiritually, I knew, our Lord knew, there was more danger for the disciples in the favor of the crowd than there was in the fury of the storm. We don't like storms. We would rather sail in peaceful seas, but storms are not always bad. The disciples have got to learn that the one who supplies the loaves and the fish is the same one who sends them into the storm. The one who sustains life with nourishment is the same one who sustains and preserves life in the storm. So our Lord is the one who sends them down to the sea, and they're to sail across the sea, and he knows full well what's going to transpire. There are no surprises in our lives when it comes to God. We may be surprised, but he never is. So the disciples are gone. The multitude is gone. And Jesus withdraws to a secluded place so he can talk to his Father. And as believers, we can't expect to make much progress in the life of God if we don't get off alone by ourselves to meditate on the Word of God and pray to the Father. We need to find that time to spend alone with our Lord. When our Lord multiplied the bread, it revealed his deity. When he draws aside to pray, it's a revelation of his humanity. And since our Lord spent so much time in prayer, I don't think we can afford to spend less time. He prayed in lonely places. He prayed on a hill. He prayed in Gethsemane. He prayed in the morning. He prayed in the evening. And on occasion, he prayed all night. So here our Lord is on the mountain alone, talking to God the Father about himself and about his disciples. And so while the disciples are out there fighting the storm, Jesus is on the mountain praying. And then we move on to the sea, verse 24. But the boat was already many stadia away from the land, battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary. From the Gospel of John, we know the boat had gone about 3 to 4 miles across the lake. It's night. Their boat is being battered and distressed by the waves. The wind was blowing in their faces, so they were making very little headway. So verse 24 is gloomy. A violent wind is blowing from the opposite direction. It's dark. The waves are coming into the boat. The boat is being tossed around like a cork in the water, and Jesus is not with them. The disciples are in real peril, but from verse 23, which has told us Jesus is praying, it's not that dangerous for them. The disciples have to be preserved in order to accomplish the task that Jesus was training them to do. They need to think correctly about the Messiah. So humanly speaking, the disciples are in real peril, but from the divine side, they were safe in the prayers of Jesus. And I wonder what the disciples were thinking about in this storm, except for wanting to get out alive. Did they think of Jesus and his power to help them? Did they realize that they lived under the eye of God and his care? Jesus had just fed over 5,000 people And a lot of them he didn't know at all. Would he not care for those he knew so well? Were the disciples looking to Jesus to help them through the storm and out of it? I doubt it. In the boat, they might even had with them some of the leftover bread and fish from the miracle of the feeding the 5,000. The evidence of Jesus' power and ability might have been sitting right in front of them as they rowed and rowed to get through the tempest. But our Lord intended to do much more for the disciples than just pray for them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. Now, the fourth watch is from 3 to 6 a.m. The disciples have been beaten by the elements for some 6 to 10 hours. They're still a good distance away from their destination. And at this point, in the heaving and the falling billows, Jesus comes walking to them. Now, you wonder, why did Jesus wait so long to come to their aid? We wonder sometimes just like that, don't we? Where is Jesus when we need him so desperately? But the storm and the disciples were in his hands. He knew exactly what he was going to do with each one of them. He waited because he knew he wanted what was best for them and best for the glory of God. Mark says the disciples were straining at the oars. And in times of peril, we're not much different from the disciples. We too, as it were, strain at the oars. There are decisions we have to make that are not easy. They're complex. We become distressed as we strain at the oars, doing the best we can to get to a safe haven. We feel all alone. We feel that we're the only ones who see the problem, and we have to handle all things by ourselves. We may feel lonely, but we're never alone because Jesus is always there. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were frightened, saying, "It is a ghost," and they cried out for fear. So in the dim light of the night, they see a man walking to them on the water. But they know it can't be a man because men don't walk on water, and they don't realize how wrong they are. To them, the Prince of Life has just become a specter of death. To them, this one walking to them is a phantom of the night, a creature of their imagination. And so filled with terror, they cry out, "It's a ghost." Now, we get into similar situations quite often. We tend to ascribe all our unpleasant circumstances to some sinister power, when in reality, it's a means that God is using to produce Christian character. And what we count to be a stumbling block often turns out to be a stepping stone. But God has a purpose in all of it. We will never find ourselves in a situation where Jesus will not know where we are and how we feel. And no storm is ever greater than he is, and we are never out of his reach. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." Jesus speaks to them in the storm. His sheep know his voice. And with one word, he abolishes all their superstitious fears. He gives them a reason to be filled with courage. He says, "It is I." And that's all we need in any storm. He's the very one who chose the disciples, guided them step by step, protected them day in and day out. And he has proved his power for them and his love for them. And so really there's no basis to fear. So his word is anchored in limitless power and infinitely, intensely personal love. Now, one of the disciples who heard him responds and does exactly what Jesus said they should do. And this one no longer has any fear. Literally, Jesus says, "Ego eimi, I am." It's an echo of the Old Testament self-revelation of God, the God who delivered Israel from the bondage of Egypt with his mighty arm. It's Yahweh, the covenant-making, covenant-keeping God, who was with you. And Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. Now, impulsive Peter is always ready for action. It seems almost incredible that Peter thought he could walk on water. But he loved Jesus. He wanted to be with Jesus. He wanted to be as close to him as he could be. And the only way he could get to where Jesus was to walk on water. Now, we normally stress Peter's failure on this occasion and fail to observe it was failure on a very high level. It was a failure in something that was Christ-honoring and Christ-exalting. Peter trusts the Lord. Peter loves the Lord. He desires to be right with him where he is and with what he's doing. And from more than one aspect, this action of Peter really merits our admiration. Peter's not afraid. And the "if" here is not a word of doubt. It could be translated "since." I say to you, if you're going to the store, will you bring me back something? And there's no doubt in that "if" at all. I know you're going to the store. And Peter demonstrates a conscious dependence on the authority and power of Jesus. Peter knows that without the permission of the Lord, he can't walk on water. Without the power of the Lord working on his behalf, he will have no ability to do this. So Peter is requesting of Jesus permission and power to walk on water. He's not reckless and he's not boastful. He realized something of the significance of our Lord's constant teaching with respect to the close relationship between Jesus and those who follow him as disciples. So Peter recognizes that this is the Lord. He expresses desire for fellowship with his Lord in an activity which is beyond possibility in human weakness. He desires a venture of faith, and the method of the adventure is absolute obedience. He makes his request. He has a passionate desire to do exactly what he saw his Lord doing. And you'll notice that our Lord doesn't rebuke him, and our Lord doesn't criticize him. And he said, "Come." And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came toward Jesus. No, Jesus says, "Come." This is the admission of the possibility of doing that which is impossible. And the motive of Peter was legitimate. Jesus will not direct anyone to do something sinful, and he would have nothing to do with pride or presumption. Jesus was pleased with Peter's request, and so he invites him to come. And in fact, Peter's the only one who did what Jesus asked him to do. "Take courage, it is I, do not be afraid." Storm is still raging. Peter goes over the side of the boat. Lightning is flashing and thunder is roaring and the waves are just billowing up and pouring water in the boat. And I doubt that when he got up on the boat and began to step into the water, that he had very much encouragement from the disciples. Thomas would be shouting, "Peter, I doubt that's the Lord." Philip, he's the practical man. He said, "Peter, think about it. You're safer in the boat than you are out there in the water." And Andrew, his brother, I know what he was saying. "Sit down, Peter. You're rocking the boat." Okay? But Peter did do what man can't do. He actually walked on water. So this is not the foolhardy adventure of a man who steps out of a boat and immediately begins to sink. He saw the possibility of the impossible in fellowship with his Lord. He asked for permission, he waited for direction, and having received both from Jesus, he walked on the water. It was a moment of greatness, and that which follows cannot undo the greatness of this experience. This is something Peter would never be able to forget. But seeing the wind, he became afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, "Lord, save me." He was walking on water. He was going in the direction of Jesus when all of a sudden things began to come apart. He saw how the wind was whipping the waves. His senses began to take over. The sensual and the spiritual are closely related, but they're antagonistic to one another. One or the other is always directing our lives, and the one that is ruling has mastery over the other one. If the sensual is reigning, the spiritual is dwarfed and imprisoned. If the spiritual is reigning, the sensual remains within its limits and does not master one's life. When Peter took his eyes away from Jesus, he became aware of the wind on his face. He did not sink immediately, but he did enter into a spiritual crisis. The text says he became afraid. Faith and fear are mutually exclusive. Where faith reigns, fear has no place. Where fear reigns, faith is driven away. In the experience, Peter's fear dispossessed faith. Problems arise when doubt replaces trust. And so you can say here, Peter panicked. When he kept his eyes on Jesus, he could walk on the water. He had won the battle of the wind and the waves, but then he turns around and loses the same battle. When he looked at the waves and felt the wind, he was filled with fear. He knew he was a man. He knew that a man cannot walk on water. His senses told him he was in trouble. His faith was great enough to get him out of the boat, but not strong enough to keep him walking on the water. And then you have the material, physical expression of that spiritual experience of the failure of faith beginning to sink. His faith was not connecting with the Lord, and his fear was being fed by the wind. He knew the waves were too weak to hold him up, and at the same time, he knew they were strong enough to drown him. It was a sad experience, but not the final one. The fact that today a man is failing or sinking on water, which he should be walking, does not call into question the validity of that great event. Sinking is not the inevitable sequence that follows walking on water. Sinking results from failing to keep in close contact with the Lord. And when he focused on Jesus, he could do what a man can't do. He walked on water. He could only do the natural when he focused on his circumstances. His faith failed, but it wasn't lost. And so he cried out to his Lord, "Save me." I think this is one of the greatest prayers in the Bible. It's short. It's a request much different from the first one he made. He said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." The mood of his soul is now that of a sense of defeat and failure. He cries out from the depths of helplessness in the agony of conscious weakness, but he will have a second venture of faith. He does not request to do anything. His prayer was short, direct, helpless, and he called on Jesus to do everything. And as Peter was beginning to sink, he once again saw his Lord as being superior to the wind and the waves. With his eyes on Jesus, he had a new vision of power in the person of God. So Peter makes a second great venture of faith. He cries out, "Lord, save me." Jesus will never disappoint a disciple in distress who cries to him in faith. And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and took hold of him and said to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" Now Jesus could have rescued Peter with just a word, but the Lord who loved Peter reached out to touch him. It was a reassuring grip that took hold of him, because I think our Lord wanted Peter to feel his love as well as experience his power. And then when Peter is secure, he gets a gentle rebuke from the Lord. "Why did you doubt? Why did you think twice?" D.L. Moody said the only mistakes he ever made in his life were the times when he stopped to think twice. So Peter was guilty of thinking back on a decision of high resolve, pausing to question where he was and what he was doing was the cause of his failure. He failed to relate to the presence, the promise, and the power of Christ. And Jesus rebukes him for his little faith or weak faith, even though the faith he has seems to be much stronger than those other guys who were in the boat. I think the rebuke was a lesson to Peter, as well as to others, that consistent confidence in Jesus is an absolute necessity. And when they got into the boat, the wind stopped. Now, the text doesn't tell us how they got back in the boat, but every time I read this, I think, well, Jesus took Peter's hand, and Peter in hand with Jesus, they both walked together to get back into the boat. So Peter did do the impossible with Jesus. They walked back to the boat, back to the commonplace. And Jesus was in the boat with the disciples, just as he was with Peter on the water. And when Jesus entered the boat, all of a sudden, the wind stopped. So the solution to all of life's riddles and problems is seeing and feeling Jesus getting into the boat. Mark 6:52 says, "Then he got into the boat with them, and the wind stopped. And they were utterly astonished, for they had not gained any insight from the incident of the loaves, but their heart was hardened." Now, these disciples have hard hearts and soft heads. They're dense. Remember Jesus said, "We got to go to Bethany, Lazarus is asleep." "Oh, we don't need to go there, Lord. Somebody will wake him up. He's dead." Okay. He says, "Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees." "Oh, good night. We forgot to bring bread." He wasn't talking about bringing bread, talking about the heresy of the Pharisees. So these guys, soft-headed and hard-hearted at this stage. They should have realized that Jesus had the power to bend and use the material universe when he demonstrated it by multiplying the loaves and the fish. They should have known he also had power over the wind and the waves. He's the Son of God. But their hearts were hard at the feeding of the 5,000. Can you imagine? Here they are, feeding the 5,000. Jesus has got the loaves and the fish in his hands, and they're multiplying. They're standing there watching fish and chips just coming out like crazy. And they're putting, they see that miracle. They take that miracle and put it in their basket. They take that basket and carry the miracle to the crowds and feed the crowds. And then they collect 12 baskets of that miracle, and probably they sat down together and ate the miracle. Okay? Now, have we missed some great things that God has done in our lives? Is everything ho-hum and lucky, and it would have happened anyway? Has God done some things in your life that you can't explain, you don't understand? God has blessed you immensely, and did you say, "Oh, ho-hum, it just happened"? There's things that God has done in our lives that are so great, we need to stop and think about them. And we should not be so impressed with the gift that God gives us as with we are with the God who gives the gift. So these boys hadn't learned anything yet. So with hard hearts, they were not able to draw the proper conclusions about the miracles our Lord worked. You see, the miracles were a kind of living parable to show you the power of God and the goodness of God, who God is and what he can do. So they were spiritually drowsy. Now, faith should be sufficiently wide awake enough to discern the proper conclusions about the works and action of the Lord. You know, our God, he's alive, he's active, he's powerful, he's looking after you and protecting you. And don't think it's all over. He's with you every day. And maybe we get to heaven, we'll find out some of the things he did for us that we didn't realize. Those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, "You are certainly God's son." Now their hearts and eyes are open as they worship Jesus. And the highest function of the redeemed soul is to worship Jesus. It's not service, but worship. It's not witnessing, but worship. And out of worship flows effective service. John 4:23 says that God is seeking worshipers. And so the aim of the Christian life is the worship of Jesus. It's a relationship to the person of Christ. Now, I think I found a few lessons out of this chapter. First of all, there are storms in the will of God. Jesus is the one who sent these men down to the boat, into the sea, knowing there's going to be a storm. Before he did this, he was watching over them and praying for them. Now, God knows that when muscles are not used, they grow flabby and atrophy. No great sailors are developed on smooth seas. And it takes the storms of life to exercise our spiritual muscles as we pull on the oars. And storms reveal the greatness and the power of God. And I honestly believe it takes more of God's power to keep us safe in the storm than it does to remove the storm. So he is not the way out. He's the way through. Second, we don't have to panic. What we need in every storm is the presence of God. He said, "It is I. Do not be afraid." We can live our lives in faith, or we can live our lives in fear, but not in both at the same time. We can live by promise, or we can live by panic. And our confidence is in the presence of Christ. And if you will listen in the storm, you'll hear the voice of the Savior. I love the story that Dr. Barnhouse used to tell of a man who owned an ice house. One day he lost a fine watch in the sawdust, and he offered a reward for anybody who could find that watch. And many went through the sawdust with rakes looking for the watch. No one could find him. When the searchers left the building for lunch, a small boy went into the ice house. A few minutes later, he came out with a watch. The men asked him how he had found it. He said, "I just lay down in the sawdust and listened, and then I heard the watch ticking." Dr. Barnhouse concluded, "Some of you have lost more than a watch. If you will be very still and listen quietly, the Lord will speak to you and show you just where you lost your power and victory, which you so sorely miss." Third, faith is maintained and strengthened by focusing on Jesus. Peter initiated his own doubt. And turning away from Jesus leads to doubt and fear. And the greater our knowledge we have of God, the greater our faith will be. Someone has said that if your problem is greater than your God is too small. Four, Jesus always knows where you are. Hebrews 13:5. "I will never desert you, nor will I ever forsake you." You'll never find yourself in a place where God cannot find you, and no storm is ever so severe that he can't save you from it. So there's no reason for the child of God to live in fear. There are storms in the will of God, painful ones, life-threatening ones, terrifying ones, but they don't last forever. Sometimes it seems as though the storms will never die out, but eventually they do. It seems as though some believers have more troubles than others, but we all suffer in some way for some time. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, "The badge of the Christian is suffering." So no matter how bad it gets, you can never be beyond the Father's care and concern. And when you're in the place of obedience, you're in the place of safety, no matter the circumstances. Fifth, keep looking to Jesus, Hebrews 12:1-2. "Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus." Never take your eyes off the Savior. The Christian life is actually very simple. It's a life where we keep looking at him, and looking to Jesus, we become like him. And the Christian life is just as simple as trusting Jesus. And then our Lord was praying on the mountain. and I assume he was praying for his disciples. He always goes before us, and then he comes up and walks along beside us. And when our situation is scary, filled with anxiety, frustrating, and is filling us with fear, we're tempted to wonder, where is God? Why did he allow this to happen to me? When your mind is filled with these kinds of thoughts, you begin sinking like Peter did. And what you need is to cry out to God like Peter did. Lord, save me. And I think Peter learned some great truths from this experience. I went through 1 and 2 Peter a couple of times to see if there isn't something in there where he gave away his secret. And I think I found two. 1 Peter 1, 6 and 7. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And then 1 Peter 5, 7, which we all know, casting all your anxiety on him, for he cares for you. To me, that sounds like a lot like, Lord, save me. Okay? Now, if you're in a storm today and you're beginning to sink, I'll give you one thing to please remember. That which threatens to be over your head is already under Jesus' feet. Let's pray. Our Father, we confess that we are weak, often foolish. Sometimes we're terrified. And life in our world can be very distressing, very difficult, and even harmful to us. Realize that nothing comes into our life that is not filtered through your hands. May we always look to you for grace, for strength, and for wisdom. Keep us from failing in our trust of you. May we always love you, praise you, and live to glorify your name. And we just thank you for all the blessings we received throughout our entire life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.